It's been a while since I've reviewed just a 3D printer hotend without also looking at the printer around it that it came in. But that is exactly what we're going to do today. This is the Slice Engineering Copperhead, and I think it's the first time a company is really serious about competing against E3D's de facto standard V6 hotend and ecosystem ever since that came out. But the Copperhead isn't just a single hotend, it's actually more of a set of hotend building blocks that you can use, adapt, or leave out as you wish, and it can actually become a drop-in upgrade for tons of printers without swapping out the entire hotend extruder and mounting hardware. So, let's run a few benchmarks and see if the Copperhead kit is worth your money. But do you know what's free? This video's sponsor, Morning Brew. It's a free email newsletter with actual news on tech, finance, and business. It's 5 minutes of reading up on what's important, written in a way that already puts you in a good mood for the day. The newsletter comes out every day, Monday to Saturday, and if you're in the US, they send it out at the perfect time to have your morning coffee with. But since my time zone is 6 hours ahead of Eastern time, it also totally works for getting up to speed during lunch, instead of spending your time doom scrolling through social media. Did you know that Roblox is more than just a meme? The company is going public next year and they're hoping to be valued at $8 billion. The power of 11-year-olds. Also, solar PV is looking to overtake coal as the largest means of energy production by 2025. It's good news. So, if you're interested in business, finance, or tech, sign up to Morning Brew. It takes 15 seconds, it's free, so check out the link in the description. Thanks, Morning Brew. Okay, so this is what you typically think about when you think hotend, right? Well, here's the thing. The largest part of the hotend, the heatsink, is actually one of the least important parts. I mean, you need it for function, sure, but it doesn't need to be precisely manufactured or made to super specific specs. So to me, the actual copperhead is this. The heat break, the heater block, and the nozzle. Here's how these parts are all special in their own ways. First, the heat break, and this one is based on what Slice Engineering have learned from the Mosquito hotend, but it's a more traditional design that skips the separate mechanical support and only uses, you know, the actual heat break tube for structure and for thermal separation of the heater block from the heatsink. This one actually. Now, it looks inconspicuous, but this is actually a three-piece assembled part. They're calling it a bimetallic heat break. You have a steel center tube, which is mechanically robust and thermally insulating. And while, for example, the standard E3D heat break is made entirely of stainless steel, the copperhead heat break uses separate copper slugs for the upper and the lower portion, so that up top, the surface that the filament touches is coupled to the heatsink as tightly as possible, thermally, which should reduce friction for the filament. And the bottom part, which mounts into the heater block, is able to transfer heat into the filament more efficiently, so it's gonna melt faster, and therefore, in theory, it should give you a more consistent performance over a wider range of feed rates and flow rates without having to crank up the actual set hotend temperature. And that's all because the copper slugs on top and bottom of the heat break are able to transfer heat more effectively towards the center tube and away from it. Then the heater block. It's copper, as the name Copperhead implies, which makes it heavier, yes, but it also helps with heat transfer since copper is just more thermally conductive than aluminum. Interestingly though, the thermal mass is about the same for a copper and aluminum block the same size. So the copper block is not automatically going to be more stable against temperature fluctuations from, you know, the filament cooling it down as it's being heated up or air blowing over it. The copperhead block is a bit more of a skeletonized block with just the area for the heater block and thermistor cartridge in the back, and then, you know, the threaded area up front for the nozzle and heat break, which they have milled away on the side and created a wrenchable area where a 12mm wrench just barely fits on for applying counter torque when swapping the nozzle. And, you know, that's been something that's always been a bit awkward on the V6 because, you know, the side where it's supposed to be putting a wrench onto has stuff sticking out, like the cables for the thermistor and the heater cartridge. Also, the copperhead block does not use a grub screw for the thermistor or the heater cartridge at all. It just uses these slightly oversized bores and then uses a screw on each end to keep them from falling out. And I don't think that's a problem for the thermistor, but the heater cartridge might start having some issues transferring its heat into the block effectively and consistently. Slice Engineering solution to that is this boron nitride paste that you're basically supposed to use on any mating surface on the hotend, and it's supposed to work as an anti-seize, thermal compound, sealant, anything basically. So you should use it on the threads of the heat break, on the nozzle, as well as on the heater cartridge and thermistor. They even recommend it for potting in the classic glass bead thermistors into the hole meant for cartridges. So this loose fit on the bores is probably intentional. And then lastly, the nozzle. And while this is compatible with the standard M6 nozzles that most other hotends use, this one is special in two ways. First, it's a 6mm hex to tighten it. So their cool torque wrench only works for Slice Engineering nozzles, not for the 7mm hex E3D and compatible ones. But their default material is through hardened steel, not brass. For thermal performance, the material properties are pretty close. So settings that will work with a brass nozzle will also work with a hardened steel one. But of course, because this one is hardened to 65 HRC, which, by the way, it's just a hair more than these Knipex side cutters. Because of that hardening, these nozzles will not wear down or kind of slightly change their orifice geometry as they get used. So it should keep printing the exact same way 100 spools in as it did on the very first day. The nozzle is also coated with what is supposedly a plastic repellent surface, so in theory, it should also stay clean for longer. Now, you might have guessed it, but all these selling points don't come cheap. You can pick and choose which parts you need or want as a printer upgrade, as you always buy them piecemeal anyways. But for reference, I just looked up how much a standard E3D V6s, which is what we're comparing the Copperhead to in this video. The full V6 is $59 on MatterHackers. And that gets you hotend with a nozzle, heater cartridge, thermistor, cooling fan, just the full set. So pricing for the Slice Engineering Copperhead. Let's start with the top. The heatsink, should you need one, is $45. The fan that goes with that is $7. The heat break is between $30 and $32. The block clocks in at $25, a nozzle at $35, the boron nitride paste at $10, and you also need a heater and thermistor. The Slice Engineering heater is a pretty powerful 50-watt one that should take the hotend up to its rated temperature of 450 degrees Celsius and costs $20. And the Slice Engineering thermistor is currently sold out, but the totally compatible E3D one is $9, which actually plays in favor of the Copperhead because the price I found for the Slice Engineering thermistor is 42 euros, but of course that one goes up to 450 degrees as well, while the E3D one maxes out at 300 degrees Celsius. So all in all, you're looking at just over 180 euros for a fully functional hotend when using the cheaper in-stock E3D thermistor. That's not cheap at all. Now, of course, you can push down the total price by substituting parts with more affordable options. For example, you could actually just straight up buy a full genuine E3D V6 kit and just buy the Copperhead heat break and nozzle, and you would get a hotend that performance-wise is gonna be practically identical to the full Copperhead except for that 450 degrees Celsius rating. But you'd end up spending just about half as much as buying the full Copperhead with all Slice Engineering parts. Now, to be fair, I don't think that's what really the intent of the Copperhead is. I think this really is an upgrade option where you buy just the heat breaks for, say, your Ender 3 and maybe throw in a nozzle, and you keep using all the other parts which you already have. Which, for just those two parts, is already more expensive than a full V6, but it's a way easier upgrade. There's no firmware changes, no mounting adapters, it's literally just a part swap and you're done. That's the spirit of what I'm doing for testing too. I'm using my Mendel 9001 modular testing platform, which used to have an E3D Hemera on there, but since there is no Copperhead heatbreak available for that yet, I've downgraded it to the E3D Titan and the classic V6. What this setup allows me to do is to use the exact same extruder, keep the heatsink, and just swap out the hot dangly bits with the Copperhead parts that are actually relevant for performance. That's going to be the heatbreak, the heater block, and the nozzle. I'm keeping the heater cartridge and specifically the thermistor as well to keep temperatures between the two hotends perfectly consistent. So starting off with just two simple test prints using Prusament Mystic Brown, which, fun fact, is actually a purple filament. I'm printing the Rogue by Strata Miniatures at 150% scale using very sparse supports and 0.2 and 0.1 millimeter layers. I'm going to be printing the exact same G-code with both the V6 and the Copperhead setups to bring out areas where one setup might perform better or worse than the other. This print definitely is a torture test, no matter which way you look at it. And honestly, I don't even think this is meant to be printed on anything but a high-resolution resin printer. It's got tons of fine details, overhangs, small areas to test cooling. It's got it all. But before I was even able to print anything on the Copperhead, it was already clogged and I had to deal with that first. Turns out the boron nitride paste pretty easily got into the hotend's bore, dried up in there, and then clogged up the nozzle in record time. I managed to get it cleared by poking at it with an acupuncture needle, but it might be a good idea to load up some nylon first thing and do a cold pull. Once that was taken care of, I ran a quick PID auto-tune and got to printing. Except, nope, still clogging. It took me about 2 hours to clear this out. So when you're using the boron nitride paste, make sure that you get none of it inside the hotend bore. Now, like I said, I skipped the easier test prints. You're not going to see a difference in a test cube or even in the benchy, so I went straight to max level. And all these prints actually speak a very similar language. The V6 and Copperhead are very similar in day-to-day performance, as you would expect. But there are some differences in the details that are actually quite significant. So yes, the right arm is gone in almost every print, and it was probably luck that it stayed on in the E3D 0.1 millimeter print. It does look like the prints with the Copperhead are just slightly more stringy, which is these fine wisps and not these thicker lines. Those are bits of the model where the printer tried to print an unsupported detail and just extruded into the air instead. But it also looks like the Copperhead prints are a bit more matte, which would usually indicate a lower extrusion temperature, while the extra stringing would indicate a higher one. Now that I think about it, the more matte texture could actually be a result of the slightly lower thermal conductivity of the steel versus brass nozzle. You know, one of the advantages of scripting videos beforehand is that you actually have a bit more time than doing it on the fly to lay out your thoughts and to make sense of them. Both hotends still managed to reproduce more of the fine details than I was expecting. A note on the nozzle though, its plastic repelling coating wasn't doing much from what I've seen, as you know, little plastic bits were still sticking to it just fine. In fact, there's some stuck on it right now. However, the absolute strong point of the Copperhead comes to light when we look at the back, and that's these support structures right here. These were printed fairly fast, which probably meant a quick transition from printing slowly on a perimeter to speeding up on a support like this. And on the E3D, it means that those support structures develop little holes where the hotend is just not responsive enough to push filament that quickly, while the Copperhead seems to be able to deliver molten PLA at whichever speed the extruder demands. And to test that, I did an actual extrusion rate test. So these should be 100 millimeter cubes printed in vase mode. They started at a fairly chill 2 cubic millimeters a second, and then by the time it reaches the top at 100 millimeters, it has cranked the speed up to reach 39 cubic millimeters a second, which using a 0.4 millimeter nozzle is way past what anyone would reasonably print at, especially in real world models where you don't have these long straight lines that actually allow the printer to fully accelerate and decelerate to and from its peak speed. Still, we already saw the implications of a higher flow design like the Copperhead in the support structures. To give a bit of context, the Prusa Mark III is limited in the slicer to 15 cubic millimeters a second peak, and does not ever actually reach that high of a flow rate, simply because the printer isn't moving fast enough. The stock E3D V6 started showing some issues, you know, at the 20 millimeter height, where the printer was pushing about 6 cubic millimeters a second, but it recovered and then totally failed once it reached 35 millimeters height, where the print stepped up to 12 cubic millimeters a second, or 11.7 peak to be exact. The Copperhead looks totally okay up until 55 millimeters of height, or if you want to factor this in, it's 50 millimeters, which corresponds to almost 20 or 18 cubic millimeters a second. That's still 3.5 times the flow rate of where the V6 was starting to struggle. That's really good. This test was done with dust filament PLA at a regular 210 degrees Celsius. Of course, you could crank up the hotend temperature and get a higher usable maximum flow rate, but that comes with more stringing and at the expense of small detail reproduction. And yes, by raising the temperature, you could also get the V6 on par with the Copperhead, but in the same way, you could also raise the temperature on the Copperhead to get even more flow rate. The three-piece heat break using those copper slugs on the Copperhead really seems to be doing a great job here. So far, it's looking pretty good for the Copperhead, but the last challenge is to see whether the heat break actually works as a heat break and how well it insulates the heater block from the heatsink to create a sharp temperature transition and to keep the hot end from clogging with PLA. I've accidentally had the hot end cooling fan on the V6 running at 10.8 volts instead of the nominal 12 volts, which results in less cooling of the heatsink, and actually got the V6 to jam pretty frequently when printing the slower feeding 0.1 millimeter prints. Measuring with my thermal camera, the heatsink managed to get up to about 40 degrees Celsius while the hot end below it was running at just 210. Once the fan was getting the correct 12 volts, it was fine, as you would expect. But I wanted to see whether the Copperhead heat break would do any better here, since they show the heat break insulated tube actually being significantly thinner than the V6s. And yeah, using the fan at 10.8 volts again, temperatures on the heatsink were down from 40 degrees with the V6 to about 30 to 32 degrees. But considering ambient temperature, that's actually about a 40% improvement, which is very significant. So considering the Copperhead is kind of meant as an upgrade, it should work just about perfectly even when used with some printers' heatsinks that might not be all that great for cooling. There is one downside with a thinner heatbreak though, and you guessed it, it's that it's not as mechanically robust, which is compounded by the fact that these are 30 bucks to replace. I think I already slightly bent mine when the hot end ran sideways into the bed because I had my Z offset set wrong. All right, conclusion time. The Copperhead comes at a cost, but it's an excellent hot end, easily beating the V6 on all the measurable performance stats. But see how I added that comes at a cost to that sentence? I really don't want just that section taken out of context. The Copperhead is an extremely expensive ecosystem, coming in at over 3 times the price of a basic V6. And even if you upgrade the V6 and go full Monty on it with a copper block, a Nozzle X, titanium heatbreak, PT100 temperature sensor, heck, you could even throw in a Hemera as, you know, your starting point instead of going for the stock V6, you would still end up cheaper than a Copperhead, and you would probably get very close to the same performance as one. So on price, it's really no competition. Where the Copperhead shines is when you just want an easy high performance upgrade using parts that you already have in your printer. The versatility of having heat breaks that fit into your existing setups is huge, and if the rest of your printer can keep up, it's one of the easiest way of upgrading the filament extrusion system. I guess too, if you care about it, the Copperhead is open source, though for something as simple on the surface but hard to actually manufacture like a hot end, I don't think there's much value in it being open source. But the drawings do actually include all the information needed to make one, including materials, coatings, and tolerances, which, for example, the E3D drawings don't always provide. Also, the Copperhead is made in the USA, and it is very keen on making sure you know that, which for half of you watching this video is going to be a big plus. For me and the other half, it's basically reading as proudly made in not my country, not that I care much about that anyways. You know, a good product is a good product, no matter where it's from. And the Copperhead definitely is a good product or a good upgrade if you have the budget for it. If you want to pick one up, there's affiliate links in the description below. As always, my reviews are not paid for by anyone, except I guess today it's a sponsor, The Morning Brew. The manufacturers don't get to see the script, test results, or the video before it goes live and so on. But I may receive a small commission when you purchase items through affiliate links. And I think that sentence is even in accordance with the Amazon affiliate rules. Anyways, I hope this review was helpful to you. If it was, give it a thumbs up. If not, a thumbs down, as Jack Frex likes to say. Also, if you're into longer form content on 3D printing and on all the things that are happening around it, check out the podcast that I do with Stefan from CNC Kitchen. It's called The Melt Zone, and you can find it on YouTube and wherever you usually get your podcasts. So thanks for watching, get subscribed for more, keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one. God, that's such a stereotypical YouTuber outro. Oh well, it's YouTube.